Welcome to another non-fictional time travel, this time as a three-dimensional 360-degree video. We are in Berlin, more precisely at Fährberliner Platz, and the red building on the other side of the street is the above-ground entrance hall of a subway station. There, underground, the actual time travel will begin. What you will see in this video can't be seen in reality today. What you're about to see, no one has been able to see for decades. It is an absolutely rarity. This video is the first part of a three-part documentary about Berlin subway stations. Each part is a time travel to a specific time period. And first of all, I want to immerse you into the colorful, aluminum-decorated world of the 70s. This is the platform of Subway Line 7 at Fährberliner Platz. The way it looks today, you can see the aesthetics of the 70s already. But I promised you that you will see something that can no longer be seen today. So now we begin our time travel to the 70s. We have arrived in 1971, the year this platform was opened. The platform is listed as a protected building since 2017, as an example of the architecture of the 70s. Surprising how much today's design nevertheless differs from the original one. I did a lot of research to be able to virtually restore the platform and could hardly believe how much has been changed. Look at the bright colors. The yellow of the ceiling and the red wall elements on silver aluminum panels. It looks like a pop art painting. By the way, the architect was a guy called Rainer Rümmler, a name I will talk about later. One more thing for those who are obsessed by details. The platform display above us shows Zwickauer Damm as the last stop of the line. Those who often use the subway in Berlin know that Line 7 ends at Rudow. Today, but in 1971, this station was not yet finished. The same is the case for the other direction, because Fährberliner Platz was the last stop there. So, to continue our time travel, we have to skip a few years. Let's take a look at the subway map. That was in 1971. It was not until 1978 that things went much further here. Now to Richard Wagner Platz. And our next stop is Konstanzer Straße. Now we have arrived in 1978, the year this station was opened. Completed, the station was already in 1973, and it is one of the few that still looks quite original today. There are only minor changes. For example, the ceiling above the platform is not that intense yellow today, and the ceiling above the tracks is orange. And of course, platform displays and so on have long been replaced, just like in all stations. The station is also a listed building since the end of 2018. Like almost all the stations I will present here. By the way, the architect was a guy called Rainer Rümmler. I can already hear the next train arriving. Let's have a quick look at the subway map. We continue north, skip a few stations and get off at Richard Wagner Platz. In 1978, this was the end of the line. The station Richard Wagner Platz is today also almost completely in its original condition. The only difference is that the floor is now covered with granite tiles. The stations of the 70s, on the other hand, usually simply had a concrete floor. By the way, the architect was a guy called Rainer Rümmler. And now I think I have played the game long enough. Rümmler was an architect and worked for the West Berlin Senate. He was construction director there for a long time, and from 1971 he was chief construction director of the Senate Department for Construction and Housing. In this position, he was responsible for the construction of new subway stations, among other things. In the 70s and 80s, there was a real construction boom of new subway stations in West Berlin, and almost all of these stations were designed and built by Rümmler. The stations are therefore not only representatives of their time, but also reflect Rümmler's personal signature. And an example of this signature are the mosaic stones on the blue walls on the platform. You could also see them on Konstanzer Straße, and they pop up repeatedly. But now let's move on to the next station, Nauener Platz. Unlike Richard Wagner Platz, this station does not belong to Line 7, but to Line 9 and is located somewhere else. Fortunately, there is a special connection between the two stations. Please look direct above you. Do you see the big round lamp? Anyone who has seen just one Star Trek episode at any time should be familiar with the following procedure. Did I say non-fictional time travel? Well, almost. Okay, Nauener Platz. And we traveled back in time 2 years again, into 1976, when this station was opened. The station still looks quite similar today. However, the concrete floor was once again replaced by granite tiles and the ceiling structure was painted differently several times. For a while it was silver, today it is light blue. As is often the case, Rümmler made a reference to the above-ground environment when designing the station. The ceiling above the platform is blue, the one above the tracks white, as are the walls. These are the colors of Nauen, a town located about 40 kilometers from Berlin. But the colors also refer to France. As you know, or maybe don't know, Berlin was divided into several sectors after World War II. Nauener Platz was located in the French sector. And besides the blue and white of the French flag, red can also be found again on the walls of the tracks. I can hear the train arriving again. Let's go on. Next stop, Osloer Straße. Here too, Rümmler has made a reference to the name-giving street Osloer Straße. I just say that's obvious. The station was also opened in 1976 and is, by the way, the only station from the 70s in this video that is not a listed building. Probably also because the only design element that remains today are the walls along the tracks. This station is an interchange station between Line 9, the platform of which we are standing on right now, and Line 8. There was actually only one difference between the two platforms. The ceiling of the Line 8 platform was painted yellow. Because of the large area that was painted bright yellow, the platform nevertheless had a completely different atmosphere as a result. However, the theme, that means the colors of the Norwegian flag, were highlighted even more in this platform of Line 9. Because the signs have red frames, the color contrast of red and blue reappears on the ceiling as well. For all the criticism that can be directed at today redesigns of subway stations, I would say that in this case, however, this was not solved so badly at all. The silver aluminum panels were replaced by blue metal plates on the platform of Line 8, here on platform of Line 9 by red tiles. The reference to the Norwegian flag is thus now clear on both platforms. Nevertheless, I definitely prefer the original condition. But now enough of that. We move on to the next station, Punkstraße. For this, we have to change to the platform of Line 8. Didn't I say that the yellow of the ceiling creates a completely different atmosphere? Now, let's quickly take a look at the subway map. We only have to go one station south. We are on the entrance level of the station Punkstraße, which was opened in 1977. Anyone who has already thought at the previous stations, more aluminum panels cannot be installed, yes, it's possible. I would say that the station looks anything but comfortable. And it is not. Have you noticed that there are an unusual large number of doors on the walls? No? Then take a closer look. If you look at the wall-like structure in the middle of the hall in front of you, and then look at the wall behind it on the left, where the two large signs are located, if you look there, you will see a door between the two signs. To the left and right of the signs are the entrances of the subway station. The station is really anything but comfortable because it's a nuclear shelter. In case of a nuclear war, the two entrances would have been air and radiation locked. In front of the entrances are airlock doors through which a fixed number of people could have passed. Through the middle door, people would have come out of the airlock and into the station. Perhaps it's because of the view backwards, but I think the color scheme and the design of the station already looks a bit like a nuclear shelter and has something frightening about it. Let's go down to the platform. Not quite as many aluminum panels anymore, but brown and red tones. Doesn't necessarily make it any more comfortable, in my opinion. Don't get me wrong, I am fascinated by the station as it is. By the way, the platform itself would have been only a small part of the shelter in case of war. Behind you, at the end of the platform, you can again see a door on the wall. The doors give access to the actual shelter, where there is a kitchen, toilets, bedrooms and so on. You can visit this nuclear shelter today. I can only recommend this. The association Berliner Unterwelten offers guided tours. Who is interested, I have included a link in the video description. Enough of the dark Cold War feeling. The next station I want to show you is called Jungfernheide and was opened in 1980. For all those who now say, but that's already the 80s, don't get picky. Also, it was already completed in 1977. Here we are, at the station Jungfernheide of Line 7. At the time, it was rather difficult to reach it from Pankstraße. Today, you would go one stop south and then take the S train to Jungfernheide without changing trains again. But at the opening of this interchange station between S train and subway, the S train personnel went on strike. But that's a complicated story which is also related to the division of Berlin and would go much too far here. Let's take a look at the station instead. No silver aluminum panels this time, but dark grey ones. The walls behind the tracks are especially richly decorated with mosaic tiles typical for Rainer Rümmler. I think the station looks quite different from many of the previous stations, and nevertheless I would argue that it reflects the 70s. The station has one more special feature which it shares with a few other stations. Behind the red fence you can see another track. This is not the track of the opposite direction. If you want to travel in the other direction, you have to go down the stairs instead, and there's an identical platform. Also with a second track behind a red fence. The two additional tracks were built for a planned subway line that was never realized after all. The poorly lighted part of the platform behind the red fence contributes, I think, quite strongly to the very own charm of the station. Let's move on. We skip a few stations, including the station Siemensdamm, which we will look at later. We get off at Rohrdamm. This station was also opened in 1980, like all stations between Mierendorfplatz and Rohrdamm. It has a really unusual design which reflects much less the aesthetics of the 70s. This is very much because of the theme. Rohrdamm, literally translated, it means pipe dam. The street is called that because the pipes between two Berlin waterworks are located under the street. Rümmler referred to this in the design by creating a construction of metal pipes above the tracks and the platform. This can also be found in the artwork on the track walls, but wheels and so on also appears here. This refers to the German technology company Siemens, which is located here in a large area. Rohrdamm is located in the so-called Siemensstadt district, in English Siemens City. And this is the keyword to now move on to the last station of this journey into the 70s, because the station is even called Siemensdamm. We are now at the entrance level of the station Siemensdamm. By the way, I'm not entirely sure if the floor tiles were actually already there in their original condition. It's unusual for the 70s because most stations have concrete floors and the platform itself of this station originally have a concrete floor too. The research is indeed difficult because I could find photos from that time and books only from the platform. Possibly there are photos in the archives of the Berlin Public Transport Company that can answer the question exactly, but because of the current corona pandemic, such research is difficult. But I'm relatively sure that this is the original condition. Anyway, let's move on to something else. Do you hear that sound? Not that again. Yes, the station Siemensdamm was also designed as a nuclear shelter, just like the station Pankstraße. Fortunately, the design and color scheme is less depressing as in case of Pankstraße. Let's go to the platform now. I think the station is even very colorful, and especially the orange metal panels still have a strong 70s charm, even though the station was built at the end of the decade. If you enter the station today, you get the feeling that the condition is very original. But that's not true. The grey concrete walls are painted green, which actually fits the color scheme perfectly, but just isn't original. The lamps on the ceiling still exist, but have no bulbs. So they are now just pure decoration. Instead, there are additional lamps on the brown ceiling. And the floor, as already mentioned, has been replaced with granite tiles. Also, the plastic elements on the track wall are no longer there. Only the round graphics and lettering are still there. Compared to some other stations from that time, you can still get a relatively good impression of how the station must have looked once. This is not the case with many other stations. Those who are familiar with the Berlin subway might wonder why I don't show certain stations that clearly shows the 70s. First of all, the station Schlossstraße, which is also a listed building. On the advertising space on the tracks wall in front of you, I have inserted a picture of this station. By the way, it is one of the few stations of this time that was not designed by Rümmler, but by the architectural firm Schüler & Witte. They also designed the world-famous ICC Convention Center in Berlin. The station Schlossstraße has been listed as a historic building since 2017. Possibly too late, because already a year earlier most of the design elements were removed for a comprehensive redesign. Today the platform looks like this. No one knows yet how far the original condition can be restored. Things are even worse at the station Rathaus Steglitz, opened in 1974. It was one of my favorite stations. At the end of 2015, extensive construction work began. Today, the station looks like this. I guess that's why the station wasn't listed in 2017 like many other stations, because there wasn't much here left already. Also hard hit was the station Bismarckstraße. It, too, looked pretty unique. Today it looks like this. It has received these green tiles that give the impression that this is a historic station from the first half of the 20th century, which is quite misleading. Most of the station is still a construction site, but the original design elements have all been removed. The same is true for the station Haarlemweg. This is what it currently looks like. And this is how it once looked. I admit, beautiful is a different look. It's also a very simply designed station, unlike the ones featured in this video. But it is this simplicity in uniform orange that makes it representative of its time. Some schools in Germany from this period have a very similar design in the corridors and entrance halls, or had such. I would have loved to show these stations not only as photos on this wall, but in 360°. But I can't do magic. That's an even bigger effort than the one I've already made anyway. So that's how our journey back in time to the 70s ends. But the journey continues. In the next part we will travel into the 80s. Different color schemes, different materials, and also representatives of their time. I hope you enjoyed the time travel up to this point. As always, let me know. If you don't want to miss the next part and more time travels, then please subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and see you next time in the 80s.